Is Georgia Governor Brian Kemp trying to reconcile with former President Donald Trump? According to the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, Kemp's camp is hoping for a detente that could at least scale down the vitriol ahead of a November matchup against Stacey Abrams and the likelihood that Trump will return to Georgia to rally for Herschel Walker and Burt Jones, the two Trump-backed statewide picks who won. But is Team Trump looking to make amends? That may be the question. And joining us now, perhaps to answer it, is Atlanta Journal-Constitution political reporter Patricia Murphy. Okay, tell us about your new reporting here on this, and if Trump is amenable to some sort of, you know, kumbaya here.
Right. Well, after Brian Kemp's really huge victory win last week over David Perdue, who was Donald Trump's handpicked candidate to bring Brian Kemp down, there have been efforts and discussions among Kemp's allies to try to approach Donald Trump and at least create some sort of truce or detente between the two men ahead of the November elections. There is enormous anxiety here in Georgia among Republicans that Donald Trump will start to attack not just Brian Kemp, but also Georgia's election apparatus and have a replay of the 2021 runoffs here in Georgia when two Republican senators lost their seats when those Trump candidates and the Trump voters, rather, stayed home and didn't back those two Republican senators. So the Kemp camp is trying to find ways to avoid a replay of that. But it seems that Donald Trump is not quite ready to have a truce with Brian Kemp just yet.
Okay, it is kind of puzzling, though, Patricia, that Kemp wants this, considering Trump is facing a criminal probe in Georgia. He's still insulting Kemp, and he's obviously still lying at this point about primary fraud, potential primary fraud.
Yeah, they don't really necessarily want any sort of an endorsement from Donald Trump. They don't expect an endorsement from Donald Trump and don't even know that that would help in the general election. But they do want Donald Trump essentially off the stage. They don't want him out in Georgia, coming to Georgia, attacking Brian Kemp from a rally stage, which is exactly what he's done. Earlier this year, he came to Georgia and said that Stacey Abrams would be a better governor than Brian Kemp. And so for those Republican voters who still like Donald Trump, still listen to him, even if they're not the majority of Republican voters here in the state, Brian Kemp needs their support and doesn't need Donald Trump trashing him here in the state and trashing especially the elections and continuing to sow doubt in the elections and convincing those Republican voters to stay home. Brian Kemp can't afford that, and his allies understand that.
We've seen what happens and of how effective Donald Trump can be in convincing Republican voters to stay home in Georgia and the impact certainly that it can have. Patricia, thanks for sharing your reporting. We appreciate it.
So Brianna mentioned the investigation into former President Trump in Georgia. The Fulton County District Attorney has subpoenaed Georgia State Attorney General Chris Carr in this investigation into Trump's efforts to pressure Georgia officials to overturn the results of the 2020 election. With me now to discuss this, CNN senior legal analyst Ellie Honig. Ellie, first of all, I just want to start with the basics here. This is a grand jury investigation. What does that mean versus a jury trial?
Very important to understand. A trial jury and a grand jury are different things, starting with what they do. A trial jury, of course, hears evidence and delivers a verdict, guilty or not guilty. A grand jury really has two things they can do. One is they can investigate, usually by issuing subpoenas, which require somebody to testify or produce evidence. The other thing they can do, if they choose, is to issue an indictment. Now, this grand jury down in Georgia is a special grand jury. They actually do not have the power to indict. They can make a recommendation, in which case presumably it would go to a regular grand jury, which could indict. The mechanics are different. A trial jury, 12 members, they have to be unanimous. The proof standard is beyond a reasonable doubt, the highest standard we have in our system. A grand jury is much bigger. Grand, 23 members. You only need a majority, 12 members, in order to indict. And the standard is much lower, probable cause. Last, John, a trial jury, of course, operates in public. Anyone can go watch a trial. Sometimes there's TV cameras. But grand jury proceedings are secret. But that only means the prosecutor in the room can't talk about it. The grand jurors cannot talk about it. However, witnesses are free to say, hey, I got subpoenaed. Hey, I just testified about this. So we're not going to know exactly what's happening in that room, but we are going to have a good sense of who's getting subpoenaed and perhaps what they say.
What do you think the crimes are that are being investigated here, the possible range?
So the DA down in Fulton County, Fani Willis, put in her letter to a judge that she has reasonable probability that the state of Georgia's administration of elections in 2020 was subject to possible criminal disruptions. Now, she didn't specify what crimes. However, if you dig a little into Georgia law, you will find it is a crime under Georgia law to solicit, meaning just to ask, for election fraud, including willfully tampering with either votes or the certification of who won. Of course, the primary focus here will be on the infamous phone call between Donald Trump and the Georgia Secretary of State, Brad Raffensperger, back a few days before January 6th, where Trump infamously said, all I want to do is this. I just want to find, keyword there, find 11,780 votes, which is one more than we have because we won the state.
Is the legal hinge here whether or not this constitutes an ask, a solicitation?
Well, it's definitely a solicitation. The hinge here is going to be Donald Trump's state of mind. His defenders will say he thought he won. He just wanted a full recount. Prosecutors, I think, are going to say, but why find? That's a strange word. And why exactly one more vote than he would have needed to win?
All right, who are the players here?
Yeah, so we know Raffensperger has been subpoenaed, as well as five other members of the Georgia Secretary of State's office. The most interesting one to me is Francis Watson, who was an investigator who Donald Trump also called her. That's the lesser known recording, but there is a tape of this. And he says things to this investigator like, I won Georgia. I know that by a lot. And the people know it. And something happened there. Something bad happened. He says to her, if you can get to Fulton County, you are going to find things that are going to be unbelievable. And finally, Donald Trump says to this investigator, when the right answer comes out, you'll be praised. That's an important piece of evidence. John, also, we now know, as you said, the Attorney General, Chris Carr, has been subpoenaed because Donald Trump asked him, hey, do me a favor, don't object to our lawsuit challenging the results. Carr did object. We also could see Lindsey Graham subpoenaed. He called down to Georgia a few weeks before. The governor, Brian Kemp, we know Donald Trump called Brian Kemp and asked him to call a special session of the legislature. What's a scandal without Rudy? Rudy could get subpoenaed as well. Remember, Rudy went in front of the Georgia legislature and he lied. That's a crime in itself. He lied about there being election fraud.
Sounds like there's some major acts left in this play.
For sure.
Ellie Honig, thank you so much for that.